looking for someone to speak, Matt Cook, Courtney's, said, you've got to have him in here. And it's been my privilege to meet Matt and his wife, Sharla. They have two children, an 8-year-old, his name Gabby, and a 6-year-old is Connor. And so we've been very impressed. I was this morning, what a great lesson that you did. We're looking forward to more today. He's from Creed Hardeman, but since I'm a graduate from Harding, I said I can introduce them to you. He's part of the mission group now, so we're very privileged to have him here. And so we have, I see on the schedule, a scripture reading, and if not, we'll come up and give our lesson.
I'll go to Luke chapter 24, verses 44 through 47. He said to them, this is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything was being fulfilled that it is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. Now he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, this is what is written, the Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in the name of all nations, beginning at Jerusalem.
Wow, what a beautiful day. After the children's contribution and the flags. You don't need to hear anything from me. That was just so beautiful. Nonetheless, you flew me all the way out here, so I probably better say something this morning. I said in Bible class, and I'll just say it again, man, we've had just a wonderful weekend here, getting to know the missions committee, and then this morning's worship has been beautiful. I've just loved everything about it. I said this morning in Bible class, when we go back home and people say, hey, how was Mesa? I'm going to be able to say it was awesome. I loved being here. Thank you for having me. About 6.5 years ago, almost 7 years ago now, our family was going to take a vacation in Lima, Peru. We lived in Cusco, Peru, which is way up in the mountains, a city of about 500,000 people. Beautiful city, but no American restaurants, no mall, no movie theaters. And so part of vacation for us was going to the big capital city where we could spend the week eating Chili's and Pizza Hut and going to the movies. Which sounds really lame for a vacation, but when you're living in a place like Cusco, great city, but that was kind of what vacation was. So that's the capital city. Every year we had to renew our students, not our student visas, our missionary visas, and we had to send them to Lima. Now that was a little bit scary to send your Peruvian ID card. I think sometimes we had to send our passport through the Peruvian mail system. We didn't like to do it, but we had to do it every year. But this year I thought, you know what? We're going. I can deliver our documentation in person to our lawyer. He can renew those documents, get it back to us by the end of our vacation, and we can bring it back, and we don't have to worry about putting all of this really valuable stuff in the mail. I thought it was a genius idea. So the morning came for us to leave on vacation. I had our entire team's documentation. There were three couples plus kids, so I had 10 little Peruvian missionary visa IDs. I had my family's passports and about $100 for each person because that's how much it costs to renew our visas and plus our vacation cash. So I had a lot of valuable stuff on me. And I remember telling my wife, Charlotte, when we left, listen, you got to help me keep track of this. And that morning, it was cold in Cusco early in the morning when we caught our flight. So I put on a jacket. It was one of those Columbia rain jackets that has inside pockets, you know, all sorts of pockets. But this had some inside pockets. So I remember, I'm blaming my wife here, I remember telling Charlotte, hey, I'm going to put this stuff on the inside pocket, zip it up, just don't let me lose my jacket. We get to Lima, land, get our luggage, we head to the hotel where we were staying, and our lawyer was going to meet us there. So we got up to our room, our lawyer was there, I was just going to hand this stuff off, he was going to take it to immigration and take care of everything, and about to hand him this stuff, and I can't find my jacket. Yeah. I actually blocked this memory out for a couple of years. I didn't remember it for a couple of years later when we got back to the United States. And I said, Charlotte, where's my jacket? And she said, I don't know where your jacket is. So I thought for a minute and realized that when we got to Lima and we got into a taxi, and we actually got a taxi van because we brought three suitcases, this is going to sound ridiculous, so that we could buy a bunch of cheddar cheese in the capital city and take it back to Cusco with us. So we brought these big three suitcases that wouldn't fit into a regular taxi, so we got a van. When I got into the van, Lima was on the coast and it was hot, probably 80 degrees. And I remembered I had taken my jacket off and laid it on the back of the seat. And I cringed just thinking about it still to this day. And when we got to the hotel, I left that jacket with all of our team's legal documentation in a van in a city of 8 million people. Yeah. So I ran downstairs. I caught a taxi. I said, listen, take me to the airport as quickly as you can, just hoping that maybe this taxi van guy, it was an official van, which was good. Maybe he'd go back to the airport. So it took 30 minutes or so to make it back to the airport. When we got there, this particular taxi driver didn't have the right sticker to get into the airport, so I had to get out at the entrance of the airport and run down the airport road. Just picture this gringo running down the airport road in Lima, Peru. And I get all the way to the place where the taxi vans are, and I see van after van after van, and then finally I look in the back of one, and there's my jacket. It had been moved to the back seat, but it was laying over the back seat. And the driver wasn't there, so I find another taxi driver. I was like, hey, do you know where this guy is? Can you find him for me? And so he radioed to me, came out, and I said, I played it real cool. I said, yeah, I forgot my jacket in there. I thought I might need it. And he held out his hand. So I pulled out 10 soles, which is $3. And I said, okay, here you go. And he held out his hand again. So I gave him another 10 soles. For about $6 or $7, I got my jacket back. I tried to estimate what it would have cost to replace all of that. And because the whole team would have had to fly back and forth to Cusco at least a couple times, plus all the documentation stuff, probably $10,000 is what I would have lost in that moment. When I got back to the hotel, you better believe I was ready for a vacation. And I remember sitting down and thinking, good grief, why are we here? It would be a whole lot easier to live in the United States where I didn't have to worry about this documentation, where I didn't have to worry about taxis, and I could just do my thing. In that moment, my passion for missions was lower than it usually was. If you were to ask me, why did we go to Peru? I would say, well, we love the people there. We have compassion on the people. We loved the country. We loved where we lived. We loved living there, and we loved what we did. But in that moment, those emotions had dwindled just a little bit. I don't know about you, but there are times in my life when I am passionate about sharing Jesus. That's the theme that you guys have given me this weekend. There are moments when I'm passionate about that, and I have a deep love for my fellow man, and I think about people who are lost, and I have a lot of compassion. But if you're like me, there are other times when I don't feel as strongly about missions and evangelism and sharing Jesus as I do at other points in time. Here's what I'm hoping. I'm thinking after a day like today, you walk out of here, and you're kind of on fire for missions and evangelism. But you know what's going to happen in a couple of weeks, right? You're not going to be quite as on fire as you were when you walked out of this thing. And that's okay. That's just natural human experience and human emotion. But it does remind me that I need something as a stronger foundation for my passion or for evangelism than just my emotions. Because if it's just about my emotions and the way I feel and how much I love people and how much passion I have, as good as those things are, those things fade. And while I might be passionate in one moment, or you might be passionate in one moment, you're going to lose some of that passion in another moment, maybe when life is difficult or the people that you're trying to reach are a little bit difficult. So we need something more foundational as a motivation, as a reason to share Jesus than just our emotions. Well, what would that be? Well, you might say, well, the Great Commission is pretty good, and you're right, but I think we can even go deeper than that, to help us find a motivation that will stick with us no matter what we're feeling. I want us to ask the question, what's God really all about? And to answer that question, I think we got to ask the question, well, what's the Bible really all about? If somebody were to come up to you and say, hey, summarize for me really quickly what the Bible is all about. What would that look like? There are multiple ways that you can lay out the storyline of the Bible. Let me just show you one, just kind of a four-step look through the Bible, just to give us an idea of what the Bible is all about. Well, we might say it starts with creation, right? God creates everything from nothing. It is beautiful. It is good. It is perfect. And as his crowning achievement of creation, he creates human beings. And he creates us differently than the rest of creation. In fact, in Genesis chapter 1, here's how he describes the creation of mankind. Verses 26 and 27. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created him. We were created in the image of a triune God, a God who is one in three and three in one, which means, I think, partly we were created for relationship, which is important in the grand scheme of the story of Scripture. So part two comes along, and we might call it the fall. Every good story has a tension that is introduced into it. Now, the story of Scripture is more than just the story, I know that, but think with me for a minute. How many of you read or saw the Hunger Games trilogy? Yeah, so a lot of people over here, maybe not as many people over here, I get that. So I read the books. I remember thinking, I'm not reading these books. I'm not a teenager, but then I read the books because they were awesome, right? So the movies come along, and I added this up one time. In the movies, there are three books, but four movies, 511 minutes. A lot of movie minutes. The tension is introduced when the reaping occurs and they draw the name of the persons that have to go to the Hunger Games. Out of 511 minutes, in minute 11. In minute 11, the tension is introduced. In my copy of God's Word, the tension is introduced on the second page of Scripture. Because here's where Adam and Eve have it made. They've got this beautiful relationship with God in the Garden of Eden. And in a moment of rebellion and choosing what they want over what God wants, everything changes and sin enters the world and death enters the world. Paul would describe it like this in Romans chapter 5. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sin. And it all begins in Genesis chapter 3 at the fall, on page 2 of my Bible. Isaiah is at one point describing the relationship of God with the Israelites and the disconnect that occurred of sin. But what he describes is representative of what happened in the Garden of Eden and what happens to all of us. Here's what he says in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, or his ear dull that it cannot hear. Watch this. But your iniquities, that's a big fancy word for sin, but your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden your face from you, his face from you, so that he does not hear. You see, when we sin, and what happened at the Garden of Eden, what happens in the life of every individual is, at some point we choose to rebel against God. There's a relationship with him that is separated. And that happens in Genesis chapter 3 at the fall. And so therefore, the rest of the story of Scripture, from that point on, tells us the effects of that, especially the Old Testament. You keep reading the Old Testament, it's just a mess, isn't it? What people do and the sin they get themselves into. If you're looking for, like, model families, there are very few examples of that in the Old Testament. It's just messy family after messy family. So you see the results of the fall. And so the rest of the story of Scripture is the story of God bringing us back to him. And we'll call this part of the story redemption. And this isn't just culminated in the cross. We can say, okay, this culminates in the New Testament. It culminates in the moment that Jesus dies on the cross, and then the moment when he walks out of that tomb alive. That's when redemption is culminated. But it doesn't just start there. You can go all the way back to Genesis chapter 3 and find foreshadowing of this. Or Genesis chapter 12, when God says to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I'll bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse." Watch this. "And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." How? Through Jesus, who comes through the bloodline of Abraham. And so even back in Genesis chapter 12, you see this foreshadowing that's going to be carried out through the rest of the story of Scripture so that all of humankind can be redeemed. And then today, we still live in this part of the story, future hope, in which we anticipate eternity with God. Now, this is a quick summary of the storyline of Scripture. Here's my question. As you look at the storyline of Scripture, how would you sum that up? What's that about? Well, there's multiple words you might use. Some of you might say, well, that's love, or redemption really sums the whole thing up. As I look at this, you know what I see? I see mission. From beginning of end to Scripture, it is a story of God on mission to bring us back into relationship with Him. Now you say, well, you're just saying that because it's Missions Day. No, I'm not. Regardless if it's Missions Day or not, I think all of Scripture, as you bring it all together and you think about what God is doing and who God is, it's about mission. It is about the mission of God from beginning to end. The grand narrative of all of Scripture points us to the mission of God. Turn to Luke chapter 24. This is where our Scripture reading came from. But I think this is exactly what Jesus says in Luke 24. This is one of the Great Commission passages that we don't focus on very often. We like Matthew 28 and Mark, but look at this. Starting with verse 44. Then he said to them, to his disciples, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." So he points back to the Old Testament. He says, all of this is actually about me and it must be fulfilled. Then, verse 45, he opened their mind to understand the Scriptures. That's big, isn't it? What's it mean to have your mind opened up to understand the Scriptures? Here's what it means. It said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem." As Jesus opened their minds to Scripture and says, here's what it's all about. You know what he says it's about? He says it's about me. It's about my death, burial, and resurrection. It's about me, and it's about mission. And so as we ask the question, well, what even is the mission of God? Here, I think, is the answer. God's mission from beginning to end of Scripture is to redeem us through Jesus Christ. Now, to fit with our theme today, we might just say it's to share Jesus with us. Isn't that what it is from beginning to end? God wants to bring us back into relationship with Him. The relationship is broken. He wants to bring us back to Him, and He does that through Jesus. He shares Jesus with us. And as we look at Luke 24 and ask, okay, what does that mean for us? It means that this message of sharing Jesus needs to be proclaimed in all the world. From beginning to end of Scripture, the Bible is about mission. And how God carries out His mission through Jesus. Now, what's that have to do with us on a day like today, on Missions Sunday? How does this make a difference in my life? So you've just seen, okay, all of Scripture is about mission. Here's why I think this is important on a day like today. As we're trying to figure out what it is that motivates us to share Jesus beyond just pure emotion. Well, I would say this is foundational. To know that God is a God of mission and the Bible is about mission from beginning to end is a motivator for mission that does not change based on how I feel. It doesn't matter if I'm a little down. It doesn't matter if I'm kind of mad at the world or mad at people or if I'm sad or if I'm passionate or not passionate. God's mission to bring us back to Him through Jesus Christ doesn't change. It is His mission. It is the story of Scripture regardless. And so here's what I think this means for us on a day like today. It means that my mission is God's mission. And this church's mission is God's mission. See, sometimes we talk about mission and our mission in life as if it's ours. And mission statements are a big deal right now. And even individual mission statements. And people say, well, I'm trying to figure out what my mission is. Or here is my mission. Well, I can help summarize that pretty quick. Regardless of where you are and what your talents are and what God has called you to do, your mission isn't really your mission. Your mission is God's mission. And this church, as you try to figure out what it is that you're supposed to do in this community. And that's difficult, and strategy matters. But the core of who you are, it's not about you. And it's not about this church discovering its mission. I can tell you what this church's mission is. This church's mission is God's mission. And that's to bring people back into relationship with Him. Now, there's a lot of great ways to do this, but at the core of who we are, it's reconnecting people back to the God who sent Jesus to die for their sins. It's about sharing Jesus. Our mission, my mission, isn't really our mission. It's not really my mission. It is God's mission. Now, what's this look like on a day-to-day basis? Because it's easy to make a cute little statement, put it on the screen. What's this do for you? Let me give you a couple ideas of how you can take this home today. Number one, if my mission is God's mission, then I will passionately support global missions. And when we give in a few minutes, we will give passionately. We will give like these kids gave. Not with any stuff, just give because God gave to us. I couldn't read their minds, but I'm guessing as they gave this money, they gave it with a whole lot of sincerity. Now, I hope that all of us will, but I know how it works. We got bills to pay. There's a lot going on. It's hard to let go of some of this. But if we believe that it's not about me, it's not about my mission, it's not about how big of a house I build or how cool of a car I drive, it's about the mission of God, then it frees me to support global missions with passion. I have some strong emotions about it because of who God is, because of the fact that He doesn't change. So today has been inspirational for me as you focused on missions. And knowing that God is a God of mission and my mission is His mission frees me and allows me and motivates me to give and support global missions with significant passion. But this isn't just about the money that you put into a plate. And let me add this. As you put money into a plate this morning, is there a basket as it's passed around? Get this. This is important. You're not just putting money into a basket. You are partnering with God in what He is already doing. You know that all of these places that are on the wall here, God is already at work there. And here's the incredible thing, when we understand ourselves through the lens of God's mission, we get to participate in what He's already doing. He's not doing it on His own. He invites us to participate in it. So when you give this morning, you are participating, not in this church's mission, though you are, not just in the church's mission, you are participating in the mission of God. And that's beautiful and that's incredible. But what's this look like as you walk out of here and live day-to-day life right here? If it's your mission to share Jesus because that's God's mission, what's that look like? Well, here's what it means. It means I intentionally share Jesus. I live on mission. I'm guessing that as you help fund some of these missionaries and that some of you go on short-term mission trips, when you go to another country, you are very intentional about the way you interact with other people, aren't you? When we lived in Peru, we were very intentional about every relationship because I saw that relationship as an opportunity to share the good news of Jesus. But if I'm honest, in day-to-day life back here in the United States, sometimes I just go through the motions. Sure, I teach college students about missions and about the Bible every day, but in the evening, we take the kids to soccer practice or baseball practice or basketball practice, or we go about our daily life. And I'm just going through the motions. I'm just trying to get them there, get them done, and get them home so we can get to bed and hit the next day. When in reality, I ought to view every relationship that I have right here in the United States the same way I view those relationships in Peru, as opportunities to share the mission of Jesus or share the message of Jesus. And that is true regardless of where you're at or what you do. What would it look like if every person in this auditorium lived intentionally on mission every single day? You could change Mesa, couldn't you? God could work powerfully through that. But it takes intention, and it's not always easy. We have to get out of our comfort zones and get out of the day-to-day routine and realize that wherever God has placed me, He can use me to share His message. He can use me if I intentionally live on mission. But here's what else this does. If it's true that my mission is God's mission, then I am just a tool in the hand of God. I'm just in His hands to be used by Him. In Isaiah chapter 10, there's this great passage where God has used the king of Assyria to punish his people. And the king of Assyria gets a big head and thinks, well, look at me. I'm pretty awesome. I'm whooping up on all these. You don't say whooping up out here, do you? That's a tennis, a West Virginia term. I'm whooping up on all these people. And watch what happens. Verse 11. Isaiah 10, verse 11. Verse 12, rather. When the Lord has finished all his work on Mount Zion and on Jerusalem, he will punish the speech of the arrogant heart of the king of Assyria and the boastful look in his eyes. And he gives us a glimpse of what this arrogant king has been saying. Verse 13, for he says, by the strength of my hand I have done it, and by my wisdom, for I have understanding, I remove the boundaries of peoples and plunder their treasures like a bull. I bring down those who sit on thrones. And he goes on and on describing this. And here's the punishment. Here's what he says about him. Verse 15, shall the axe boast over him who hews with it? Or the saw magnify itself against the one who wields it? As if a rod should wield him who lifts it, or as if a staff should lift him who is not wood. Here's the point. Saying, does the hammer look at the person swinging the hammer and say, look how awesome I am? No, it's just the tool and the one who's swinging the hammer. And Isaiah reminds us that that is all we are. We are simply tools in the hand of the one who uses us, regardless if we want to be used by him or not. Now, that's freeing as you give in a little bit, because as you give, you can see yourself not just as given to the church can do missions. As you give, you are becoming a tool in the hand of God to share the message of Jesus across the globe. I guess 5 years ago, my first year teaching at Freed Hardeman, first year as a professor, you're just trying to figure things out. There's this steep learning curve, man. It was hard stuff. So I'm just trying to get through every day and trying to get my classes ready. And I taught a freshman level Life of Christ class. It was a 7:30 class. It was an early class. It had a few athletes in it because they tend to take the earlier classes so they can get to their practices. But a good class. And I had this tendency, because we're a Christian school and about 80% of the students are members of Churches of Christ, to assume that everybody knows everything, especially with the life of Jesus. And so I would say things like, well, there's this, but you guys already know about that. About, I don't know, a third of the way through the semester, a student came to me and said, I'm kind of struggling in your class. I didn't do well on the first test. And he said, the reason is, he said, I'm a Muslim. And I don't know anything about Jesus. Now, I should have picked up on that earlier in the semester. But this was a hard class. He didn't know. He knew nothing about Jesus. And so the rest of the semester, I slowed down a little bit. And I was more intentional about the way I talked and about making sure everybody understood what we were talking about. At the very last day of the semester, I did this activity. I did it that semester and didn't do it again. Our iPads could connect to the projector. And so I had the name Jesus on the iPad. And I said, if you could give one word, adjective, noun, whatever, to describe Jesus as we talked about it this semester, what would it be? And then I wrote it, and they could see it on the screen. I know the handwriting looks like a two-year-old. It's hard to write on an iPad. So we went through the whole room, see the answers they gave, kind of what you would expect. And this particular student sat in the very back corner. And when I got to him, I had said, if you want to pass, you can. So I just kind of assumed he would pass. But I got to him, and I was curious what he would do. And he looked at me, and he said, the word that you find in the bottom middle of the screen, Savior. I was an idiot. I didn't even know who this kid was and what his background was. But he had picked up through the course of this class that Jesus could be the Savior. I was a tool in the hand of God, and I didn't even know. I didn't do anything. I didn't know what I was doing. I was just surviving, and God still used me. And here's the last thing I would say you need to do with this. I live on mission wherever I am and whatever I'm doing. You see, this isn't just about a contribution that then goes to people who do mission work across the globe. This is about you walking out of here today and saying, you know what? Whatever I'm doing tomorrow, I participate in the mission of God and therefore share Jesus with those around me. Whatever your job is, whether you're at school, whether you're in a factory, whether you're in a business or in a hospital, wherever you're at tomorrow, God invites you to participate with him in his mission. See, if I'm just counting on my emotions to motivate me to share the message of Jesus, my emotions fade. In fact, in my household, me and my daughter are the drama queens. Yeah. Thankfully, my wife and son are pretty stable. We're the dramatic ones. I'm pretty dramatic. My emotions come and go. But if I understand myself as a participant in the mission of God, it doesn't matter what I'm feeling that day. I understand that it is a part of who I am. It's a part of my identity as a follower of Jesus to share Jesus, because my mission is not my mission. It's God's mission. So as you walk out of here today, maybe one thing I can challenge you to do that helps make this a little bit more concrete would be this. Somewhere, on a card, on a mirror, put it somewhere, a sticky note, put today, write this, today I live on mission. Because if you're like me, you have the tendency to go through day-to-day life and not think of yourself as being on mission. But if my mission is God's mission, then every day I'm on mission. Imagine, think with me here, if every member of this church walked out of their doors on every morning of every day, and said, you know what, today, I may feel some different things, I may face some difficulties, life may not be everything I had hoped it to be, or today may be great, but every day, today, I am on mission. Imagine if every member of this church viewed their lives as a mission. Imagine the impact that you could make in Mesa, Arizona. All for the glory of God. Here in a moment, we're going to sing a song of encouragement, which is meant to encourage those maybe who need to respond to Jesus, maybe to put him on in baptism, or maybe, I'm guessing this is a family that prays for one another. Maybe you need the prayers of this church, and this song's an opportunity to do that. But all of it is because of the mission of God. And the mission of God, I think, is all because of who God is as a loving Father, a God of love. A little over six years ago, we were living in Peru. Everything was going great. Loved what we were doing. Loved life. Loved our job. And we were at home on furlough for just a couple of months. And our daughter, who was eight now, was two at the time, was diagnosed with a rare form of liver cancer. It was the kind of cancer that could not, at least hers in this case, could not be cured by chemo. They tried chemo for a couple months. It didn't work. And very quickly said, she's going to have a liver transplant. That's the only way to get this kind of cancer out. So we were on the transplant list for a couple of months. That was the point at which we knew we could not stay in Peru. That's why we're here in the United States today. We would probably still be there today, or at least be thinking about transitioning out around this time period. So she had the liver transplant. She's had a bunch of complications, but praise God today, she's doing great. But we recognize that at any point in time, things could go south again with her new liver. And it's happened a couple of times. She's just had a variety of problems with her new liver. And we know that if that happens, there'll be a couple of options. One option is we wait on another child, as awful as it is to think about another child to die, which is what happened the first time, so she can have a new liver. Or if things get urgent enough, they'll probably say to us, they could say to us, listen, we need to do a living donor transplant. The liver is an amazing organ. Basically, they can go in to someone who matches her, cut a part of their liver out and put it in her, and it'll regrow. It's incredible what it'll do. Now, if it were to come to that, and they were to come to me and say, Matt, you're a match. We need you to give a piece of your liver, a pretty good-sized chunk of your liver, for your daughter to live. How quickly do you think I will respond in the affirmative? I'll say, let's go to the surgery room right now. Let's go. Why? Because that's how much I love my daughter. And I'm no different than any of you, parents or grandparents, who would do the same thing in a heartbeat for the people that you love. But here's what's amazing. My love is so imperfect. I am selfish and sinful, but I still love my daughter that much to do that. How much more does a perfect God with perfect love love us? How much more beautiful is the love of a Savior who didn't give his liver for us. He gave his life for us. So why do missionaries mission. Why share Jesus? Because the whole Bible is about mission. God is a God of mission, and I'm convinced what drives that mission is His beautiful, powerful, and incredible love. It's beyond any love that I'm able to produce in my life. That's why we can talk about mission. That's why we can offer an invitation. If you need any help, don't you come as we stand and sing together.
Something. Aren't you glad he's here? Woo, man, coming in, man, that is exciting. Did you think about what God has done in his life? Wow. What did Jesus say? You know, in the end of the book of Matthew, chapter 28, he came in and looked at the disciples, and he came to them, and he said, "All authority has been given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go ye, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, teaching them to observe all things I have taught you, and lo, I'll be with you when? How long? Always, even to the end of time." And then Mark says, "Go into all the world and what? Preach the gospel to all creation. He who believeth and baptized will be what? Saved, and he who disbelieves will be condemned." You know, I was 20 years old in Casa Grande, and someone started teaching me the Bible, and I heard these verses. And so on January 1st of 1961, I was baptized in Christ down in Casa Grande. And I was serious about that stuff because I read that. You know, I found these verses like in John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the what? And the life. No man cometh to the Father except by who? By me." Wow. And then there was that verse in Acts chapter 4, verse 12. That said, "There's no other name under heaven given among men by which we can be saved except who?" J-E-S-U-S, Jesus. And you know what? Gene and I were serious about what we read. This stuff is real. This stuff is true. And so things happen in our life. 9 years after I was baptized, I found myself in Chiang Mai, Thailand. Doing what? "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come unto God except through who? Jesus." And all the people in Thailand are what? Back then it was 25 million. 95% of them are Buddhist. "No one can come unto the Father except by who? Jesus." Thailand now has 70 million. And so that gospel, everything I read in the book, is true. All the things that Jesus told us to do was true. And guess what? That same transformation that happened to me 50 years ago